How important is the mining sector to Canada?
That's huge. I mean, when you look at the number of companies on the Toronto Stock Exchange that are involved in the natural resource sector, the stats are astounding. Billions of dollars of economic activity, hundreds of thousands of jobs all throughout Canada, literally every province and territory. So this type of convention, you can tell, I believe I was told there are going to be 24,000 participants is the expectation. That's a huge sign of how important this industry is and this type of event is to our country and our economy.
Now, I understand that you've been having a few meetings throughout the day. Could you kindly share the nature of those meetings? What kind of meetings does the leader of the opposition have at a mining convention?
Well, meeting with some of the senior officials at the organization itself, who are talking about some of the general policy issues that they believe the government should be doing to support the sector. So, for example, we've had discussions about the mineral exploration tax credit. It was extended in this budget, but only for 1 year. The ask, which was supported by the Finance Committee, was that this tax credit should be extended for 3 years to give that certainty to the investors around the world. There, when they make investments to explore, often there are longer time frames than just 1 year. So that wasn't done in this budget. That was a missed opportunity. Heard about that. Heard about the infrastructure requirements that are needed to tap into areas where we know there is wealth and resources, just can't get to it. And the cost of doing that in Canada being so much higher. We have a shorter season, huge time of the year where we can't get into the field, or our companies can't explore. Other countries can. So keeping Canada competitive on a general level, when we know that countries like Australia have been growing in leaps and bounds in the last few years. Also meeting with some ministers of other countries as well to talk about some of the issues that we're facing together. You know, how do our counterparts in other countries find that balance between environmental protection and development of natural resources, different countries interacting with their indigenous populations as well. And so it's been a very interesting day.
Some of the issues that we're dealing with most immediately is this prospect that the U.S. president has suggested putting on tariffs onto Canadian steel and aluminum. How should the Canadian government respond?
Well, first and foremost, there should be a plan. The budget was tabled last week, didn't have anything set aside, no framework even mentioned, no dollar amount budgeted into the fiscal framework about what to do with these trade disruptions. We've got NAFTA looming. That's big. That's huge. That's the whole piece of trade between Canada and the United States. You would think that even with that going on, that alone would be enough to say, okay, we need to have a contingency plan or factoring that in. We have $18 billion deficits before there's a problem with steel or aluminum or with NAFTA in general.
But how do we tackle this right now? I mean, there are tweets about it. There hasn't been anything concrete. How do we tackle that now? How should the Canadian government be responding to that now? Should we be more proactive? What should we be doing?
Well, look, I've always conceded that this particular administration would be difficult to deal with for any political party here in Canada on the trade issue. It's not as, it's far more protectionist, and we're seeing that more and more. And I believe that Canada needs to do a few things. First and foremost, when it comes to a budget, that we saw last week, there needs to be something set aside, even if it's just a recognition that the government's finances could be thrown out of whack. That wasn't costed in, that wasn't factored in. We've talked about it's incumbent upon the government to talk about some kind of a contingency situation where companies that have to take these trade disputes to international tribunals could get support for that while they're doing that. That's been done in the past, specifically in other areas. Or at the very minimum, and this is something I think that this government really missed an opportunity. The Liberals didn't speak at all to keeping Canada competitive. One of the things that helps our position at the negotiation table is when there are American companies saying, hey, we want access to Canadian markets. We need to get in there. We want to be able to develop and explore and expand and open up factories. When Canada, under the Liberals, are raising taxes, imposing a carbon tax, raising payroll taxes, adding regulatory regimes, new regulatory burdens, that clamor for access into Canada starts to quiet down because the decision's already been made to invest elsewhere. Over $87 billion worth of investment in the natural resource sector has left. Stats out just recently talking about the decline in foreign direct investment. That means that those companies who have access to the U.S. administration, they're not fighting to maintain that access into Canada. So those are some of the policy areas where this Liberal government really did miss an opportunity.
Just to get back to that budget, you've given us a glimpse as to how you feel about the federal budget that was tabled last week. What should have gone into that budget? Yes, we've discussed NAFTA. Yes, the deficits. What should have gone into that budget?
Well, I would have liked to have seen a plan to get back to balanced budgets on the original time frame that Justin Trudeau campaigned on. He promised Canadians that the deficit would be eliminated next year. Canadians voted for a balanced budget. They voted for a balanced budget by 2019. He's broken that promise. The fiscal framework is completely broken now. There's no plan to get back to balanced budget. Now, conservatives talk a lot about that. We need to make sure that people understand why we're so committed to balanced budgets. The deficits today mean higher taxes tomorrow. It means my kids will have to work most of their adult life paying back spending that occurred long before. My son Thomas will be 40 before the budget's balanced. That's not fair to him. Interest rates are going up. That means that cost of borrowing becomes higher and higher. So that's the deficit part. The Liberals cut about $2 billion from infrastructure spending here in Canada, but they're committing to building infrastructure projects in other countries. They committed $500 million for the Asian Infrastructure Bank, which will not build a single kilometer of road here in Canada, won't create a single new water system here. They've hired a minister from Kathleen Wynne's government to start a study on pharmacare, which you'll excuse me if I don't have much confidence in anything coming out of Kathleen Wynne's government. So overall, there wasn't anything in that budget really that gave conservatives confidence that this government has a handle on what's going on.
Before we let you go, your take on the Ontario election?
I won't get involved in other party races. We just had one in Saskatchewan where I stayed out of it, my home province. Of course, there was one in Alberta as well recently. I'm encouraged that the next leader of the PC Party of Canada, all of the candidates so far have pledged that they will oppose the federal Liberal carbon tax. That's great news. I see a situation where Saskatchewan, Alberta, and Ontario can all work together to fight back against this carbon tax as the next provincial election cycles come around. So I think it's clear that Canada needs Ontario to be doing well. It's a huge economic engine. There's so many aspects of our economy that perform better when Ontario is doing better, whether it's high energy costs driving out opportunities here in the country, in Ontario, whether it's the higher taxes. I'm confident that after the next provincial election, we'll have a small C conservative government that's open to investment, that's addressing the affordability issues for hardworking Ontarians. Canada will be better off for that, and so I won't get involved in who will carry the banner for that side, but we will be watching the next election with a great deal of interest.